call your attention to Joshua chapter 2, read and hearing very beautifully. Begin at verse number 1. Now Joshua, the son of Nun, sent out two men from Achaia to spy secretly, saying, go view the land, especially Jericho. So they went, came to the house of a harlot named Rahab, and lodged there. And it was told the king of Jericho, saying, behold, men have come here tonight from the children of Israel to search out the country. So the king of Jericho sent to Rahab, saying, bring out the men who have come to you, who have entered into your house. They have come to search out all the country. Then the woman took the two men, hid them. So she said, yes, the men came to me, but I did not know where they were from. And it happened as the gate was being shut, when it was dark, that the men went out. Where the men went, I do not know. Pursue them quickly. You may overtake them. But she had brought them up to the roof and hidden them with the stalks of flax, which she had laid in order on the roof. Then the men pursued them by the road to the Jordan, to the fords. And as soon as those who pursued them had gone out, they shut the gate. I want to speak to you from the subject this morning, making a decision to be on the Lord's side. Picking sides is so important. Would you not agree? When you think in terms of being on a particular side, there are times that people will ask you, whose side are you on? And then you ask people, whose side are you on? You know, when I think in terms of where we are today, looking at the political landscape, you have to ask yourself, are you on Donald Trump's side? Are you on Hillary Clinton's side? And depending on whose side you're on, more than likely you will have repercussions. Sometimes it happens this way when you have an argument in the family. And there's the husband's side, and then there is the wife's side. And the children have to determine whose side are you on. Well, I believe that there is your side, my side, and there's the right side. What I like about this particular story is that here is a woman who was a lost pagan. She lived in the city of Jericho. And the most important thing about her is that she was a harlot, which means that she was a prostitute. She lived in a culture that was unchaste, degenerate, decadent. This culture served a goddess, goddess Astaroth, who was a goddess of sensual love. There was a harem of prostitutes that would engage in sexual relationships with men in the name of worship. Somehow this was to bring prosperity to the land. So prostitution was an accepted trade in this today. And you ask yourself, why is this woman so prevalent in the scripture today? Why does God choose the story of a prostitute in order to highlight who he is and what he does in the lives of men and women? And I'll tell you why. It's because this lady had to make a decision. And the decision that she made made all the difference in her life. It affected this woman culturally. It affected this woman domestically. It affected this woman even spiritually. But she had to make a decision whether she was going to be on the side of the king or whether she was going to be on the side of God. And in our story today, she made the decision because when the king sent to this woman and said to this woman, there are some men who have come into your house, wanted this woman to turn these men over. Woman said that they were here. And I know that was a lie. I'm not here to just try to justify. I'm just telling you what the woman said. She said that they were here, but they're no longer here. Am I right about it? The Bible said that what she had done, she had hidden them on her roof, hidden them under material that would conceal them from exposure. When I talk to you this morning about making a decision to be on the Lord's side, I want to illustrate to you at least three things that happens when you choose to be on the Lord's side. Number one, I want you to know, to be on the Lord's side, God's side, it has to be a decision by faith. What do we mean by faith? The Bible says in Hebrews 11 and verse number 6, but without faith, it is impossible to please God. He that cometh to God must believe that he is. Watch this, must believe that he is a reward them that diligently seek him. Why is it important for us to believe that God is? That's because God is invisible. You and I don't see God. You and I don't talk to God and God talk back to us. We can't put our hands on him, but the Bible says that the only way that you and I can please him is that we must have faith. What is faith? Bible said in that same Hebrew epistle, faith is the substance of things hoped for. It is the evidence of things that are not seen. What is not seen? God is not seen. Faith is the substance. Faith is the foundation which a man must predicate his belief. That is, in an unseen God, here's a woman who chose to be on the Lord's side, but that simply means she's putting her faith and her confidence in a God that she has not seen. But what I like about this woman is that this woman has a testimony. Listen to what the Bible says in Hebrews 11 and verse number 31. The Bible says, by faith, the harlot Rahab perished not with them. Watch this. The Bible says that the harlot Rahab perished what? Not with them. That, watch this now. I want to see that by faith, the harlot Rahab did not perish with those who did not believe. That's the way that translation reads. There is a difference between those individuals in Jericho who perished and Rahab. What's the difference? Difference is that Rahab had faith. Had faith in whom? She had faith in God. She had faith in a God that she did not see. The people in Jericho did not have faith in that unseen God. Therefore, when you consider Rahab and her decision to be on the Lord's side, she had to move by faith. The Bible says in James 2 and verse number 25, likewise also was not Rahab the harlot justified by works, when she had received the messengers and had sent them another way. Here's what I'm learning about faith. Faith is not just in the unseen, but faith, ladies and gentlemen, is faith in the unseen and demonstrated by one's work. When a man says that I'm on the Lord's side and I believe in God, then that man must demonstrate. There must be something in his life that testifies that I am a believer in God. You and I can't just say it with our mouth. God is looking for evidence that we have truly put our faith and our confidence in him. True faith, ladies and gentlemen, always has to be demonstrated by works. James, his own record, when he wrote his epistle, he said, faith without works is dead. A man is justified by his works. A man's faith is made perfect by his works. So in this day and time, as you and I make a decision to be on the Lord's side, you've got to operate by faith. And that faith must be demonstrated by what you and I do in our lives. We can come here and we can sing these praises to Almighty God. We can come and we can pray to him, but it's what we do that will determine whether we have truly made a decision to be on the Lord's side. May I say to you that this faith that I'm talking about, somebody say, well, Brother Gibbs, is it a blind faith? Someone say, well, I would much rather put my faith in what I can see, in what I can touch, in what I can feel. Well, I understand that, because that sounds logical, that to see it and to be able to handle it is probably a better choice when it comes to putting confidence in something and trusting something. I would much rather see my wife and touch my wife than to say that I have a wife and I trust my wife. That's the way it is with God. I understand that many times you and I would love to believe in a God that we could talk to every morning and would talk back to us and we could tell what it looks like. But that's not the kind of relationship that God is expecting of us. So, is it a blind faith? No. I know it's not a blind faith. I want you, Brother Tucker, to go to Joshua chapter 2, and I want to look at verse number 8, and I want to show you that here is a woman who truly believed in God, but her faith in God is not because of a blind faith in God. In verse number 8, what did the Bible say?
And before they were laid down.
And what says that? Before they were laid down,
she came up onto the roof.
Now watch the woman. She came up on the roof. Read.
And she gave unto the men.
And she gave unto the men.
I know that the Lord hath given
now,
to the land.
Now I want you to notice what the Bible said. The Bible said, the woman said, what? I what?
No.
I know that the Lord. She didn't say I. Yes. She said I what? I know. No. If you're going to choose to be on the Lord's side, God doesn't want you thinking and guessing and saying, maybe there is a God. God said, if you're going to be on my side, you got to know that I am here. Am I right about it? This woman said, what I know. No,
that the Lord.
I want to show you something else. The woman didn't say, I know that you have possessed the land. She said, I know what?
The Lord
has given you. That the what? The Lord has what?
Given you.
Have what?
Has
given. Watch this. You don't have to work for it. The Lord has what? Given it to you. Here's a woman expressing her faith. Her faith is in an unseen God. Here's a woman who is demonstrating her faith by making a choice between her king that she has served for many years and a God that she does not see. But here's a woman who said, I know I see the king, but I know the Lord has what?
Has
given you the land. Read.
And that your terror.
And your what?
Terror.
Your
Watch this.
And all the inhabitants, read.
Of the land.
Of the land.
Faint.
Faint.
Because of you.
Because of you, read.
For we have heard.
For we have heard.
How the Lord.
I like this. For we have what? We have what? Heard. Over there in Romans 10, verse number 17. The Bible says, faith come by what? Hearing. Faith come by what? Hearing. And hearing by the what? By the word of the Lord. But watch the Bible, read on. If you don't mind, Brother Tucker.
For we have heard how the Lord dried up the water.
We have heard how the Lord hath done what?
Dried up the water.
Alright, read.
Of the Red Sea for you.
It was God who opened up the Red Sea. Can you read?
When you came out of Egypt.
When you came out of Egypt, read.
Or what you did.
Now, here's this woman. She said, now, I know. I need to walk just a little bit. Is that alright? Is that alright? Now. Let me share something with you. Oh, I like this much better. Amen. Amen. Let's read them just a little bit. Now listen to me. Here's this woman who has faith in God. And my question is, why does she have faith in God? Why does she have faith in a God that she has not seen? I tell you why. It's because she knows that the God of Israel is the God who opened up the Red Sea. Now, based on the fact that I know that the Red Sea was open, that simply means that somebody had to open. Am I right or wrong? Now, let me just talk to you right now. You want to know why a woman has faith in God, in a God that she does not see? And because she knows that the Red Sea was open and could nobody open up the Red Sea. Why not? She has been worshiping the God of Ashton. But the God of Ashton has never. Open up the Red Sea. Somebody said, well, why should I be on the Lord's side? Because when you get to your Red Sea. Good to see Greenville Avenue here. Amen. Y'all snuck in on me. Am I right about it? No. But no. But God. Open up the Red Sea. And you want to know whose side I'm going to be on? You want me to choose between the king? You want me to choose between the king and the God's half brother? No, I'm going to make my choice. And my decision is on a God who can open a Red Sea. Amen.
Yeah. When you came out of Egypt.
When you came out of Egypt.
And what you did unto the two kings of Amorite.
What you did. Read.
What you did unto the two kings of Amorite that were on the other side of Jordan.
Now listen to me. I'm almost through. Because I got to make the point of why I'm deciding to be on the Lord's side.
Well.
Talking about a God that I don't see, but I do know this, that there were some great kings on the other side.
Yeah.
And you all are nothing but peasants, slaves, ex-slaves. get by. This woman was smart. She may have been a prostitute, but she was smart. She knew how to take care of her business. She's a business woman. You don't be in that profession and not be a good business woman. Oh, she knew how to take care of that. She knew how to care for me. She did it for the money, not for the honey. No man knocked on her door. When no man knocked on her door, and she found out that they were Israelites, good business woman said, "Come on in." I really wish I could talk to you. I really did.
Put together.
She started calculating. She said, "I already know, based on history, that the land is yours. I don't care about these walls. I don't care about our history. I know it's your God, not mine, your God. He's given you the city." And let me show you something else she said. I don't have much time. She said, "I know he's the Lord of heaven and earth." I'm going to put my faith in something. I surely don't want to put it in. Am I looking all right? Am I really looking all right? Don't fool me now. I got to move to point number two. I've spent a whole lot of time in point number one. And that's talking about making a decision for the Lord. It's got to be by faith. Why put your faith in a man? Why put your faith in things? If you want to be successful in life, put your faith in God. God said, "I'll never leave you and I'll never forsake you." I'm talking about a real God. I ain't talking about no fake God. I believe it. Making and shaking. You don't make it in a marriage. You don't make it in a marriage without God's help. No, I'm on God's side. I'm just being honest. It's a whole lot of things that would have torn us asunder, but God. If I had time, I'd tell you about a God of love, a God of mercy, a God who forgives, a God. That's the kind of God I serve. I'm not serving a God who wants to shout me and push me and punish me. I serve a God who's in the saving business. And when I get in trouble, I go. Call on some of these brothers and they won't hear you.
Well.
I don't know who's with you. Where is he tonight?
Well.
Here's my next point. Listen to me. This woman, to be on the Lord's side, had to become a part of his plan. Her life now has to be dictated by his plan, not hers. Whatever. said, save me. That's what she made a plan with him. Save me. Save me, my mother, my father, my father, my mother, my brothers, sisters,
and all they that have,
and what?
And all that have, and deliver our lives from death.
Now, John, the only way that that's going to happen is that whatever plan she had now have to be dictated by God. So don't come tell me where I figured and I thought. It isn't what you figured, what you thought. He wants to know. If you really want me to save him, here's the plan. We're going to let you down. You let us down by this father God. And he says, leave that car in the window. Am I right? Bring your mom, your father, all your siblings, bring them all to your house. If they go out, it's on them. And if you tell it, the plan is null and void. You know what our problem is? I preached too long on point number one. I got to hurry up and quit. Here's the point that I'm making. That God's plan is a plan that means that we have to fit ourselves into his plan. When I think about God's plan is an eternal plan. And when I put my plan and my life in the hands of God Almighty, and I let God be the one to orchestrate and to guide and to give me instruction as to how I am to carry my life, if I do it like God said to me, then I am assured of the fact that God will save me and God will protect me. So as I move on hastily and come to a conclusion, by putting her faith in God, she had to put her faith in his plan. And everybody had to come from their house into the house of Rahab. And then that scarlet cord had to be on that house and hanging from that house in order for them to be saved. As I close now, I want to share with you, God has an eternal plan today. And if you want to be on God's side, you have to put your plan in God's plan. Lord, help me to understand what is your plan. God said in the dispensation of the fullness of time, I will gather together in one all things which are in heaven and which are on earth. All things in him. And I write about Ephesians chapter 1 and verse number 22. And have given him to be the head of all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him that filleth all in all. God, what are you doing? I got a plan, and I'm putting all things in that plan in Christ and in the church that Jesus Christ is building. And so as I close now, I want you to know that as you go through life, whatever you are planning, whatever you're doing, you ought to make sure that it's in keeping and in the house that God has provided for all of his people. All people have to be in this one house, and that one house is the church of our Lord Jesus Christ. When you make your plan, make sure you get where God has his power, has his plan, has his salvation, and is in the church of Christ. Am I right about it? Lord, I know I'm moving too fast, but I gotta hurry now as I close, as I talk about God's plan and your plan. Now the third thing is, when you give your life to God, choose God, and get on God's side, then God not only blesses you here presently, but God will even bless you in the future. Here is a woman who gave her life and put herself on the side of God Almighty. She chose God's people above her own people. Chose God above her own God. And when she came into the dwellings of the Israelites, watch how God blesses this woman. God not only blessed her by saving her on that day, but God turned around and used this woman in order to bring the Christ child into the world. How do you know what it is? Because Abraham get Isaac, Isaac get Jacob, Jacob get Judah, Judah get Abraham, Abraham get Abraham, and
nobody but God Almighty. God has turned your negative into a positive. And I heard about it. God fixed it where Salmon looked on her, married her. And then when Salmon married her, the Bible said that they brought forth, Mary brought forth a child by the name of Boaz.
Someone here who is almost persuaded. We don't want you to forfeit salvation.
salvation and miss out on this grand opportunity to be one with Christ and to make that decision to be on the Lord's side. As we sing, there's still time to come. All night and all day, you know the angel who watches over me, my Lord. I'm singing all night and all day. I've got an angel. It's still time. He's watching me all night. He's watching me all day. I've got an angel. He watches me, my Lord. We're singing all night and all day. I've got an angel watching over me. Well, amazing grace, how sweet it all sounds. I've got an angel watching over me.